Hello students, today we will start with the remaining C++ properties. In the last video, we have discussed about class, objects, encapsulation, abstraction and polymorphism. And we have studied that how they are interrelated to each other and what are the properties of C++. Today we will start with the next property of C++, inheritance. Now, what is inheritance? Inheritance is one of the main and very important property of C++. So, inheritance is, it is the capability of a class to derive properties and characteristics from another class. Inheritance is one of the most important feature of object-oriented programming language. Now, I give you one more example of inheritance. I will give you one real life example of inheritance. See, let's take an example of a family. For example, in a family, you have grandfather, father and son. So, father is inherited from grandfather. So, as father is inherited from grandfather, so there are chances that father has some properties like its father. And father can also have some properties of its own. So same way, third generation is son. First generation is grandfather, second generation is father, and third generation is son. Son is inherited through father. So there are chances that son can have some properties of father, as well as son can have some properties of its own. So this is the concept as we used in C++, inheritance. Inheritance is how we can derive the properties of the previous class to the new class. So the main task of inheritance is, or the main thing that inheritance provides, is reusability. So what is reusability? Inheritance supports the concept of reusability, that is, when we want to create a new class and there is already a class that includes some of the code that we want, we can derive our new class from the existing class. So inheritance provides the facility of reusability, which means, for example, we have created a class. And in the class, there are some data members or member functions. Now, suppose we are creating a new class. And as we have created a new class, we want to use some data members or member functions which are already defined in the previous class. So, there is no need to again define the data members or member functions, because we can simply inherit it from that class and we can use it. So this process is known as reusability. So let's compare it with the real life example. As in your family, I have explained you that there are three generations: grandfather, father and son. So, if father is inherited through grandfather, so father must have some properties of grandfather and he must have some properties of its own. So, which properties he has inherited from his father, he can, or grandfather, he can use it as it is. So, in the same way, inheritance provides us facility to reuse the functions and data members. Now, next class is how we can inherit and what are the things that we study in the inheritance. Now, look at the diagram. In the diagram, there are two classes, class A and class B. and there is a downward arrow from class A to class B. So it means class B is inherited from class A. So if class B is inherited from class A, then class A is the parent class. Here it is parent-child relationship. A is parent and B is child. So A is parent class and B is child class. Parent class is also called base class, or child class is also called derived class, because we are deriving the class or the functions from the previous class. So that's why it is called derived class. There are so many names that we can refer the classes. So one is parent child, base or derived class. Next is super class. We can also call base class as a super class. So the definition, or you can get definition of any with any name, like what is base class, what is super class, what is parent class. So super class is the class whose properties are inherited by the subclass. So it is called base class or super class. Subclass is the class B, which is inheriting the features of class A. So next is, what is subclass? The class that inherits properties from another class is called subclass or derived class or child class. So the class whose properties we are inheriting is called superclass, and the class that is inheriting the properties is called subclass. So you can easily explain inheritance by just taking a simple example of parent-child relationship or a family hierarchy relationship, like grandfather, father, son. So you can explain by taking any of the example. Next is types of inheritance. It is very important topic, very easy topic, and most of the time you can get this question as in exam as types of inheritance, or you can also get a question with the any single type of inheritance. Like they can ask you any one inheritance, what is multiple, what is hierarchical, or what is the difference between both, or they can ask all these methods also. So it is very important question. So, and it is very easy and simple. So there are total 5 types of inheritance: single inheritance, multi-level inheritance, multiple, hierarchical, hybrid. Now I will explain you all these methods one by one by taking examples. Now first is single inheritance. Single inheritance is also called simple inheritance. Now what is single? As the name is single, so how we are using it in definition is, in single inheritance, a class is allowed to inherit only from a single base class. The class, which means the derived class, is allowed to inherit it from a single base class. So when only one class is inherited, you can also write it in another way. So when only one class is inherited through only one class, then it is called single inheritance. Now look at the diagram. For example, class A is the base class and class B is the derived class. Here class B is inheriting the properties of single class A. Class A is only one class, so that's why it is single class. So class B, you can also explain the diagram. If they can ask you question in 3 mark or 2 mark, so what you have to do is, you have to draw the diagram and you have to explain the diagram. It is very easy to explain it. So you can write here that class B is inherited from class A, which is a single class. So these type of inheritance is known as single inheritance or simple inheritance. Next is multiple. Multiple means many. So when a class is inherited through multiple base classes, when a class is inherited through multiple base classes, then it is called multiple inheritance. So multiple inheritance is a feature of C++, where a class can inherit more than one class, that is one subclass. Subclass means derived class or child class. It means only one child class is inherited from more than one base class. In multiple inheritance, the base classes can be more, one or two, or it can be three. So when but A is a combination of B and C, which means A is also inheriting some properties of B and A is also inheriting some properties of C. So this is multiple inheritance, when a child class is derived from multiple parent classes. So that is multiple inheritance. Next is multi-level. Now there is a lot of difference between multiple and multi-level. Multiple means many, so that's why there are many parent classes. But multi-level means level wise. Now I will explain you how it works. Multi-level inheritance, in this type of inheritance, a derived class is created from another derived class, or a derived class can be created from a class which is also derived from another class. So now look at the example. For example, class A is the derived class and it is inherited from class B. Now here, if we take example of only A and B, so A is the child class and B is the parent class. Here B is the parent class of A class, but B class is also inherited from another C class. So C class is the parent of B class. So there are generations, like if you want to take your family tree example. So here it is, class C is your grandfather, class B is your father, and class A is son. So there are total three generations. So class A is inherited from class B, and class B is also inherited from another class C. So that is multi-level inheritance. So the definition is, when a class is inherited from a base class or parent class, which is also inherited from another base class. So this is the main difference between multiple and multi-level. Now next inheritance is hierarchical inheritance. Hierarchy means tree form. Whenever the word comes hierarchy, hierarchy means tree form. So when we represent relationship in tree form, as you have studied trees and binary trees, so you must know that a parent node have two child node, that is hierarchical form. So in the same way, in this type of inheritance, more than one subclasses or more than one child classes is inherited from a single base class. It means here base class remains single and there is only a single base class, but there are multiple child classes. Parent is single, but there are multiple child classes. So this type of inheritance is called hierarchical inheritance. Now look at the diagram. Class A is the parent class and class B and C is the child class. So two child classes are inherited from the same parent class, that is class A. So that is hierarchical inheritance. Now there is a difference between hierarchical and multiple. Now look at multiple. Multiple is when there are multiple parents, when a single child class is derived from multiple parents. Here child is single, but parents are multiple. So class A can have properties of class B as well as class C, that is multiple. Hierarchical is exactly the opposite of multiple, where there are two child classes. और मेनी चाइल्ड क्लासेस कैन बी इनहेरिटेड फ्रॉम अ सिंगल पेरेंट. सो क्लास बी कैन हैव द प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ ए एज वेल एज क्लास सी कैन हैव द प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ ए. सो दीज आर द मेन टाइप्स ऑफ इनहेरिटेंस. नेक्स्ट एंड द लास्ट टाइप ऑफ इनहेरिटेंस इज हाइब्रिड. हाइब्रिड मीन्स कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ एनी टू इनहेरिटेंसेज. When we combine any two methods, it becomes hybrid. So, hybrid is, it is implemented by combining more than one type of inheritance. For example, look at the diagram. Here, I have taken example of hierarchical and multiple inheritance. Class A, class B, class C, class D. So, I have combined here two inheritances, hierarchical and multiple. So I hope it is clear to everyone, and it is very important topic. In the later videos we have to do programs on inheritance, so it is very important that you people must know the basics, that what is simple inheritance, what is multi-level, and all the inheritance. I hope it is clear to everyone. Single, multiple, multi-level, and hierarchical. So, next topic of C++ property. Next C++ property is binding. Binding means linking. Linking means how we have to link the code. Binding means matching the function call with the correct function definition by the compiler. See, I have explained you in the functions, that calling function, called function, how they works by combining each other. First calling function works, then it passes the value to the called function, then called function perform the operation and return the value to the calling function. So this is actually a type of binding, linking, how they are linked with each other, and how the linking occurs when we run programs or when we compile programs. So that all comes under binding. So C++ provides us facility to perform binding at different steps. So we will study about this. So here the definition of the binding is matching. Binding means linking, and then matching the function call with the function definition. Connect the function call with the function definition. Function call means calling function, and function definition means definition of function. Function calling always ends with semicolon, I have told you that, whereas function definition always ends without semicolon. So to connect these two things are known as binding. Now next step is how and when the binding occurs. So there are two things at which binding occurs. The first is either at the compile time or at the runtime. Now compile time is when we compile the C++ program. For example, when you people after writing the program, when you people click on compile, that is compile time. And runtime is when you are executing. When you click on run after compiling, when you click on run, it will run your program. So at that time is known as runtime. So I hope it is clear to everyone that what is compile time and what is runtime. Compile time is when we click on compile, and I have told you that what is compiling. Compiling means, for example, you people have typed a program in C++ in the Turbo C. Now your program is in English language, but your computer doesn't know English language, and he doesn't understand English language. So, but we people don't know binary language, as computer understands binary language. So compiler allows us to type the program in English language, and when we click on compile, it will convert our program into machine language, and then computer understands and reads the program and generates error. If there are error, it generates error, and if there is no error, it displays the message there is no error and the program is successful. Now you can run it. So that is all compiler do. Next is runtime. Runtime means your program is has been read by the compiler. Now it is ready to execute. So just click on run and you can check the output. So that is runtime. So these there are two types of binding. One occurs at compile time and one occurs at runtime. So here are the names accordingly: early binding, late binding. The first type of the binding is early binding and the second type is late binding. Now what is early binding? In the early binding, the compiler matches the function call with the correct function definition at the compile time, which means I have told you that in the binding means match the function call with the function definition. So when this happens at the compile time, when matching of function call with function definition happens at compile time, it is known as compile time binding and it is also known as static binding. Now why it is known as static binding? It means we are allocating the space and everything to the program at the compile time. We are allocating resources at the compile time and we cannot change these storage requirements or these types of resources later. So they are fixed because we have fixed it at the compile time. So that's why it is known as static binding. Now the second case is late binding. Now what is late binding? The compiler matches the function call with the correct function definition at the runtime. In this case, the matching of function call with the function definition is done at runtime. So that's why it is known as runtime binding. And now why it is known as dynamic binding means we are allocating the space after compiling the program. So if we are allocating the space after compiling the program, we can change it accordingly, that how much storage is required and what type of resources are required. So we can change the things at this time. So that's why it is known as dynamic binding. In the compile time binding, we have to set the storage requirements earlier and we cannot change it in the later stage. So that's why it is known as static binding. Whereas in the late binding, that's why the name is late binding, which means the compiler matches the function with the function definition at the runtime. Early means we are taking decisions at early stage. We are taking decisions at compile time. So that's why the name is early. Whereas late means we are taking decisions of the memory requirement after the compilation of the program. So we are taking decisions late. So that's why it is known as late binding. So now there is one more thing, that which type of binding is better and in which type of binding we can use the storage space requirements in a better way. So the answer is dynamic binding. Late binding is the best method of binding, because in the late binding we have facility that we can change the storage requirements and we can take decisions after compilation. So we can decide that what type of resources are required and how much exactly memory is required. So it is one of the best method. Now, the last property of C++ is message passing. As the word is message passing, so how message passing happens in C++? So objects communicate with one another by sending and receiving information to each other. I have told you in the previous video that everything whatever we have to do in C++ program, we have to perform the task by object, means how function calling and the function definition works. Here we make use of objects to make the connections or to pass the messages. So message passing is done by objects. So how it works, objects communicate with one another by sending and receiving messages to each other. And I have earlier told you that in a single program we can use 2-3 different objects as according to requirement. So a message for an object is a request. It is a request for execution of a procedure and therefore will invoke a function in the receiving object that generates the desired result. So message passing involves specifying the name of the object, name of the function, and information to be sent. So all the information in a program passes through message passing. So students, that was all for today. And these all are the features of C++ language that are very important, and these are the basics of C++. So I hope it is clear to everyone, all the functions. So tomorrow we will start with the next topic. So that's all for today.